Good afternoon, and thank you very much for the invitation to participate in this exciting meeting. I'm sad that I can't be there in person. Unfortunately, we need to get rid of this pestilent plague. And after that, hopefully we'll be all able to get together in Dublin and enjoy a nice Guinness, which I greatly miss. Anyhow, I'm going to talk about incentives and rewards for assessing researchers in their career trajectory. I have a couple of disclosures. One is that I'm leading the Hong Kong Principles Initiative and also leading the Top for Academic Institutions group. And I will be mentioning both of those within my talk later on this afternoon. In academic world, those of you who are there will be very familiar with how do we get from a lecturer up to a full professor? What are the criteria that people use to enable the progression of a researcher's career? And we set out to look at this in 170 universities around the world. And we used a variety of methods to do that. And we looked at, we were interested in 12 criteria. Five of the criteria were what we would call traditional, such as things like journal impact factor, the number of publications, and seven of them were non-traditional activities such as publishing in open access journals and data sharing. And you can read the details in the paper that was recently published. And what I wanted to do, though, is share with you two sets of results. Although we went to look at 170 institutions around the world, particularly faculties of medicine, we were really only able to look at about 100. And so that's a very important result in that there are several universities where you simply cannot find what criteria universities are using, or faculties of medicine in this case, are using to promote and tenure their faculty members. But what we did find of those approximately 100 institutions we were able to look at is that the vast majority used very traditional criteria, regardless of the stage of the researcher's career. And very few of them used these, as I mentioned, these non-traditional criteria. So we really, most academics have heard of the publish or perish phenomenon, that really publications are the currency for research. And in academic settings, if you want to get ahead in many, many faculties, you need to publish, and you need to publish as much as you can, as quickly as you can. And university ranking schemes themselves are based on productivity. And what we see also is an increasing number of students require publications to complete their degrees. So, people have taken this to great lengths. Here's unfortunately a person who died. But on their tombstone, they've got a QR code that will take you directly to all of their publications. So, in some quarters, more seriously, people take publications incredibly seriously. And sadly, in other situations, here is a tweet that I found a little while ago. In the University of in Cardiff University in Wales, a colleague had committed suicide, in part we know from this tremendous push to publish or perish. And the university's response to this was to simply make it more difficult to open windows. And in a sense, in my opinion, this is a sort of a very sad reflection on what appears to be all too prevalent in trying to move your career forward. And if we look at the Lancet in 2014, had a series on increasing value and reducing waste. And what they wanted, university teachers and a whole bunch of other stakeholders were to sort of to look at the data, so to speak, and examine more forensically whether they're sort of getting the bang for the dollar. So were universities getting the bang for the dollar by simply promoting this sort of behavior of publish or perish? And just to give you one example, if you looked at the quality of reporting, whether it was the abstract, the methods, the results, the discussion, or indeed the data, there were really quite fundamental problems with the research integrity, the research trustworthiness of biomedical research. And there are many problems in biomedical publications. I'm not going to go through all of these, but we really see that there is significant problems around reproducibility, whether around the prevalence of spin, and the endemic poor quality of reporting. And also, unfortunately, there's quite a rise in researchers publishing in what I would characterize as fake journals. And data sharing is uncommon. Even though data sharing is known to accelerate discovery, and I will come back to this theme on more than one occasion. So during COVID, the Wellcome Trust had an initiative which they produced very early in the year, and they wanted their researchers to share their data and their findings, their results. And the Wellcome Initiative was signed by endorsed by hundreds of organizations. And specifically, the Wellcome Initiative stated in part that researchers, journals, and funders, they needed to ensure that the research findings and data relevant to this outbreak were shared rapidly and openly to inform public health. Sadly, missing from this stakeholder groups were academic institutions, which are typically the home of researchers. And yet, if we look at the adherence to these initiatives, what we see, at least in sort of one example of over 500 COVID-19 papers in preprint servers, and only approximately, one in five of them had any data availability statements, and even worse, only about one in 10 of them had any data availability. So despite the best intentions of this initiative and many others like it, it doesn't seem to be having an effect. And the question is, why? And sadly, we have some very strange literature coming to the COVID world. Here we have a mathematical solution to COVID. And it would be really wonderful if editors and peer reviewers knew what they were doing and actually were somewhat incentivized for what they're doing and incentivized for some form of training. And sadly, we've seen a number of increased retractions. There is a recent paper in the Journal of Medical Ethics, which gives somewhat of a deep dive into at least the first 33 retraction, major retractions. And again, You know, why is this happening? Is it somewhat related to perverse, really the perverse incentives and rewards that are in academic institutions? And I hope that these slides that I've been able to convince some of you, perhaps even only 10%, that the notion of the quantity of publications is perhaps not a particularly smart way to continue to assess researchers for promotion and tenure. And really this comes down to the notion of our researchers, our academic institutions, are they upholding research integrity? Because research integrity is really a fundamental part of that, is the notion of trustworthiness. And I hope that some of the slides you've seen here, me sharing with you this afternoon, would give you some cause for concern at the very least about the trustworthiness of this type of research. And so what I think, and a growing number of people think, is that academic institutions need to sort of move away from these perverse incentives and rewards, particularly the number of publications and journal impact factor, et cetera. And really they need to think about incentivizing researchers and rewarding them for trustworthy research. And I'm going to try to spend the rest of my time sharing with you some thoughts that some of us have. I do also want to make it very clear to you that we're not the first in this area, nor will we be the last, and some may argue we're not the most sensible. There's a lot of people who are in this space who are working together to try to make incentives and rewards more trustworthy as well. One of the early initiatives was the San Francisco Declaration of Research Assessment, DORA, where they explicitly state that academic institutions should not use the journal impact factor to assess researchers for promotion and tenure and career projection. And the goal of the Hong Kong principles was really to try to foster research integrity. As I said, research integrity is really very, very connected to trustworthiness, and to provide guidance for those completing research assessments to strengthen research integrity. And we concentrated on primarily on what research organizations could do, and really try to focus on implementation, because if you can't implement this, then it's very difficult to get people to change. So the Hong Kong Principles was published this summer. I provided you with a URL. You can go and read more about it. It was developed in part of last year's World Congress in Research Integrity. There are five principles in this initiative. And I'm going to go through just a couple of them with you and give you some ideas about implementation. And perhaps it'll be useful for you in thinking about how you may take this back to your own institution to see whether there might be some interest in moving forward. So one of the principles of the Hong Kong principles is to value accurate and transparent reporting of all research, regardless of the results. And we see that, for example, Wellcome have a journal, an open access journal, and they are very keen to publish results regardless of whether they're statistically positive or negative. And there are a number of journals that are also willing to do that as well. In terms of trying to help with accurate and transparent reporting, the Equator Network includes a library of over 400 reporting guidelines to help researchers ascertain which guidance will help them report their particular type of study. Everything on the Equator website is free. And we, again, would encourage people to use this, and we would encourage academic institutions to incentivize their constituents, their researchers, to think about looking at the Equator Network. We know that, for example, here is an example of a randomized trial showing that the use of reporting guidelines improves the completeness and transparency of reporting. And there are many other examples of this as well. So there are ways to incentivize researchers to more trustworthy research. And we also know that, what I want to do now is sort of change to another principle. This is another principle within the Hong Kong principles. Value the practices of open science, such as open methods, materials, and data. And we know from this paper is an example, Michel Mello and colleagues show that in general, that patients are keen for their data to be shared for research purposes. We also know that data sharing is associated with added value. Here's an example of randomized trials that shared their microarray data, were much more likely to have their research cited, which is an important way of disseminating research, is to ensure that it is being cited. Another example of valuing the practices of open science is something called data champions. So the Technical University of Delft in the Netherlands, they borrowed an idea from Cambridge University that sort of developed data champions. And Delft went one stage further, and they allowed data champions to use this information as part of their promotion and tenure. So what do data champions do? Well, a data champion would help researchers who are keen to share their data, but actually don't know how to do it, don't have the resources to do it, to make that happen in reality. So I think this is an innovative example of an implementation where a university have said, if you help your colleagues to enable data sharing, you can use this in your promotion portfolio. And recently, some colleagues published in Nature, taking research integrity, the notion of trustworthiness, taking it from the talk to the walk. So really taking it from, here's some ideas to how do we implement it. And there are some excellent examples in this paper of implementation of strategies, as I've mentioned. And the Hong Kong Principles paper also has several examples of implementation as well. So what we want to try to do is really see, really promote university transparency. And a group of us are involved with the transparency and openness promotion for academic institutions. So just let me give you an example. If we can go down to the third row here, where it says data, materials, and code transparency. And a current institutional standard might be data sharing is not documented as an expected practice for promotion and tenure. But a basic top adoption would be that it mentions that data, materials, or code sharing is a valuable contribution to scholarship and hiring and will be considered in hiring, promotion, and tenure decisions. And then an advanced top for institutions for this particular item would be that the institution sets a minimum threshold for proportion of research data that actually needs to be shared. So I won't go through all of those examples, but here is just, we're sort of working up towards this. And what we hope to do is to go back, once these are developed, to go back and look at universities, including perhaps, let's say, Trinity College Dublin, University College Dublin, University College Galway, to see how do these universities fare in their openness for hiring, promotion, and tenure. And I think this will be, I think, something that universities might well look to. There is a similar initiative for journals that has worked extremely well. I'm going to end with just a few thoughts from the Chief Scientist of Australia, where he said, you know, people respond to incentives, and a change will come only when grants and promotion are contingent upon best practice. And I hope that I've been able to convince a few of you, at least, that this best practice is really quite related to this notion of trustworthiness. We shouldn't really be interested in people simply publishing research that is not trustworthy. We should really encourage them to promote trustworthy research, and we should actually incentivize them and reward them for doing so. Thank you very much.